Now, before we get into the mechanics of how to activate and use offline sync, let's have a quick look at all the pieces involved. Of course, we have a remote database. This is our master store of data on Azure. We'll also have that local database, most likely SQLite, where we store our local copy of the table and also where the local changes are kept until they're synced. Now, each table that we keep an offline copy of will have a synchronized table interface that we use to do our queries. That's where we update our data and then push our changes up the remote database. And we'll also use the mobile service client, and it has a property on it named sync context. And we haven't used this yet or set it up, but this is where the real magic happens. The sync context is associated with a mobile client object, such as an iMobile service client, and it tracks changes that are made with sync tables. Now, the sync context maintains an operation queue, and this keeps an ordered list of CUD, sometimes said CUD operations. And I said that correctly, because that's create, update, and delete. And these will later be sent to the server. Now, the synchronized table objects know about the associated sync context, and they write local changes made to the local store to the operation queue that will then be pushed to the server. Now, your code will use the sync context property to pull the remote changes back to all of the local tables. Now, the first step is to set up a local store used as the data persistence layer on your client. Now, the client SDK provides a default local store implementation based on SQLite, but you can implement your own local store. So if security was of utmost importance, you may want to encrypt your database, use something like SQL Cipher, for example. Now, we'll use the default. So to create the SQLite store, we'll create a new table store object, a mobile service SQLite store, and then we'll pass in the file name. This is the file of name for the database stored on the local device. And the name is not really important. Again, that's just a local copy. As long as we connect it to our mobile service SQLite store, everything should be happy. Now, next, we need to define each table we want to store in the local database. This is done through calls to define table. This is generic, where the T is the data transfer object. Now, you can also pass in a JSON object, which can be used to infer the shape of the data. Now, if you need more than one table, then just add additional define table calls. The local store object will examine the DTO or the JSON block, and then it generates a SQL table in the local SQLite database to hold data for your object. And finally, we need to associate the local database storage with the mobile service client. We do this through its built-in sync context property. We must call initialize async first and pass it in the local database store. And this is what activates the local caching support. And again, notice this call is asynchronous. This is what executes the database initialization code, opens the SQLite database, and if necessary, creates the tables in our local database. The second parameter is a sync handler class, which is used by the context to process table operations as they're synchronized to the server. And the pass-in object must implement the iMobile Service Sync Handler interface. Now, this is really just an extension point into the Azure Client Framework, and it includes a couple of methods. There's execute table operation async, and this is used to execute a single table operation on the Azure remote table. And there's also on push complete async, and we use this to do post-processing after the push completes. Now everything is set up to support offline caching, and we just need to use the correct implementation of our table interface. Now remember, we used getTable to retrieve the table interface for a live connection, but for supporting a local cache, we're going to use a variation called getSyncTable. Now there's both a non-generic and a generic form of this method, and the same rules apply. This method returns an iMobile service sync table interface, which replaces our original iMobile service table. Again, just notice the word sync getting inserted. Now, using the iMobile service sync table should be a pretty easy transition. It exposes the same methods used on our original table interface. For example, here's a code to insert a new entry into a diary table. Now, the big difference with this implementation is the code will continue to work even if we lose our network connectivity. Let's go a little bit deeper and look at the architecture and the interactions between the players. Now, when you perform table operations on the iMobile Service Sync table, such as an insert operation, it delegates these to the associated mobile service sync contacts, which in turn pushes those changes to the mobile service store. So in this case, our SQLite implementation. The database store will make sure these changes get pushed to the local database on the device. It will also record the changes to a pending operation queue stored on the same database. You then decide when those changes are pushed up to the Azure Mobile App backend by calling the push async method. This is defined on iMobile Service Sync Context. Now, this is the sync context on your mobile services client. Pushes an operation on the sync context and sends all create, update, and delete changes since the last push. Now, it's not possible to send only an individual table's changes, because otherwise operations can be sent out of order. Now, the push executes a series of REST calls on your Azure Mobile backend, which in turn will modify the server database. This will retrieve the pending operations from the local database and then send them one at a time to the remote Azure database using the table endpoint. And it uses the same operations we use with live endpoints. So post to add new records, patch to update, and delete, of course, to delete. Now, finally, if a record has multiple modifications against it locally, if it was, say, inserted, then updated multiple times, only the final state of the record will be transmitted to the Azure on a push. So it won't be pushed multiple times. Now, push async will push our changes to Azure, but we also have to pull remote changes back to our local database. This will update our local copy with any changes performed by other clients. We do this on a table-by-table basis by calling the pulse async method on the sync table object. This will use the mobile service client to retrieve all of the entries from the remote database and then write these records to our local database cache. Now, one optimization we can do with the pull API is to enable incremental sync. So to turn this on, we pass a string parameter called a query ID to the method. And by supplying a value for this, the client will keep track of the last time that specified query ID was issued and then only pull down data changed in Azure since the last query. So it uses the update at column that the Azure automatically puts onto every table. And only records with an updated at value greater than the last synchronized record will be retrieved. And you can see the query here. So notice the updated at filter being applied automatically. Now there's another optimization that the client SDK does to try and help out. And this is for, on unreliable networks. So rather than trying to pull all the data down at once, it does it in chunks. Now in both the incremental sync and full sync, the client API requests the server records in 50 record chunks, and it continues to request pages until the server returns less records than requested to ensure it gets them all. I.e. if we get back less than 50, we know we're at the end. Now each chunk is then written to the local cache, of course. So this synchronization process is a manual trigger. So the code's done for you, but you have to cause it to happen, you have to invoke it. And keep in mind that the synchronization is all asynchronous, so it won't block your UI. Now the recommendation is to perform a full synchronization when your app first starts up, and then each time you make a change to the local database. So here, we've created a local method to do the push-pull operation, and then we call it when we update the diary entry. The synchronize method performs the steps necessary to perform a synchronization. So let's walk through these steps. First, we can check if we have network connectivity, and we'll do this using the cross-platform open source connectivity plugin. Now this has a single call to detect whether we've got a valid network connection. So it could be Wi-Fi, could be cellular. And this step isn't strictly necessary, but the network IO call will fail and throw an exception if we don't have network access. And so it's just more efficient to test first before attempting to use the network. Then we push all of our local changes up to the remote Azure database. This is done through the sync context push async method. And this pushes all the create, all the update, and all the delete operations that were done to the local store up to the server and uses the same REST endpoints used by the normal table interface. Now, this is the most common point of failure when synchronizing the database. You should always execute this method in a try-catch. It will throw an exception if the modified record version does not match on the server side, and this could indicate that a different client has changed the same row. Next, we we pull new and changed records for each of our synchronized tables. Now remember, this is a table by table operation, so you will have one call per synchronized table, and records that were changed locally are not returned. And this is done by calling the pull async method on the sync table object. Now it turns out that the call to push async is actually redundant in this case. If a pull is executed against a table that has pending local updates which have not been synchronized, then the pull will first execute an implicit push on the sync context. And this just helps minimize conflicts between changes that are already queued and new data from the server. Now the second parameter passed to pull async is the query use on the server side to pull the records. And we can pass create query to return all of the records. Or we can provide a custom query to retrieve a subset of records from the server, and the sync context will then insert the return data into the local store. The first parameter to the pull operation is a query ID that is used to identify the query on the client. As mentioned previously, if you use a non-null query name, then the client will perform an incremental sync where each pull operation returns only the records changed since the last pull. And the updated at value is cached off, and subsequent pull operations will only retrieve records after that timestamp. Now the query name can be any string you choose, but it must be unique for each logical query in your app. Otherwise, different pull operations could overwrite the same incremental sync timestamp, and your queries would return incorrect results. Now you should really only have one query per table and ensure that the query encapsulates the data you want to retrieve. Now this makes incremental sync work the most efficient, and it takes up less CPU and memory overhead in your client app. Now you can also pass null as the query name to turn off incremental sync, and this will of course then just pull all records that match the query. This is suboptimal since it pulls records that you have not been changed and you shouldn't need that data. You can clear the contents of the local store using the iMobile Service Sync Table purge async method. Now this may become necessary if you have stale data in the client database, or you wish to discard all pending changes. So the purge will clear a table from the local store. Now if you just want to remove a specific set of records from your local database, then you can pass a query into purge async to be, more specific. Now the other case where purging your local cache becomes important is when records are deleted on the server. So if soft deletes have been enabled on the server, then the synchronization process will detect these deleted records and delete the local copy. However, if soft deletes are not enabled on the server, then deleted records will remain in your local cache even though they're not on the server anymore. So just like push async, calling the purge method will push any local modifications first before it actually purges the local store.